I'm very excited to introduce Chris Whipple. Chris is a highly acclaimed writer, documentary filmmaker, journalist, and speaker. He's a multiple Peabody and Emmy Award-winning producer of CBS 60 Minutes and ABC News Primetime. He is a writer and executive producer of The Spy Masters, CIA in the Crosshairs, airing on Showtime. And if that wasn't enough, we're here to talk about his new book. For his new book, The Gatekeepers, Chris conducted interviews with all 17 living White House chiefs of staff and two former presidents to provide us a behind-the-scenes look at how they influenced the presidents that they served in the course of history. The Gatekeepers is already garnering praise. Kirkus Reviews described it as a well-researched, well-written review of a unique government position, informative for the general public, and an insightful blueprint for a new administration. Publishers Weekly described it as a page-turner of history, and that it's enhanced by having actual historical players contribute well-rounded and sometimes surprising characterizations of presidents and other Washington luminaries. Tonight, Chris will be in conversation with Ken Duberstein, who was President Reagan's chief of staff from 1988 to 1989. And acting as our moderator for the evening, we have Peter Baker, the chief White House correspondent for the New York Times. So without further ado, please help me welcome them all to Politics and Prose.
Test.
Hello. Okay, great. thank you very much for the introduction. Appreciate it. I'm so happy to be here tonight. Politics and Prose is my local bookstore, and I obviously know it's yours, and what a great institution this is in our community, and I'm so happy to have a chance to come by and be part of it. I'm really happy to be here for this book. Chris Whipple has done a fabulous job, and I'm not allowed to blurb the book on the back, so I'm just going to use this opportunity to shamelessly promote it right now. It's a terrific book. Anybody who cares about how White Houses work and is interested in the characters who are part of them, you're going to find this a great, gripping, and very illuminating read. And one of his characters, and by the way, if you haven't seen it, the documentary that this sort of was born out of, in which he interviews Ken and all these other chiefs of staff on camera, is terrific. It's just a great way to get into this subject matter. And he got them all, Republican, Democrat, doesn't matter, they all trusted Chris, and they came to the table and told their stories, and I think we got a lot out of it. Ken is just, a rock in Washington, obviously. He is not just that he was President Reagan's last chief of staff, he also was his legislative affairs director, he was deputy chief of staff, he came in with Howard Baker at a moment when Reagan was on the rocks, and he helped turn around a presidency. He's been a wise man in this town for chief of staff and presidents ever since. So we're really lucky to have both of them here tonight.
Can I jump in?
Yeah.
Number one, you're going to hear both something very unusual in Washington today. The press and the White House agree that his book is terrific.
Yeah, that's right. Finally, we have unity.
On a bipartisan basis.
Chris is a unifier, not a divider. Right, uniter, exactly. Not a divider.
But having participated both in the documentary and the book, and speaking on behalf of the other White House chiefs of staff, Chris got it right. And he appreciated the role that we all have played based on the role that the president, or whichever president we serve, gave us. We were all empowered by our presidents, some more so than others. But all the stories that go into serving a president, Chris really has picked the wisest and the best. And I just want to compliment you. And I can blurb the book. So
there you go.
Are you the honest broker on this one?
Fabulous.
So anyway, I'm sorry to jump in.
Not at all.
If I could jump in now for 1 second, let me just say that if the book is any good, if it sheds any light on what it's like to be White House Chief of Staff, it's thanks in large part to these two guys. Starting with Ken and the documentary, he was the wise man that I relied on. I think the first chapter was Ken's idea, actually, to lead with that. When I finally got around to writing the book, I brazenly sent the first chapter to Peter Baker. And Peter and I had met but didn't really know each other. And I said, gee, would you mind giving it a read? And he not only did he read the first chapter, he sent copious notes. He read every chapter in progress and gave me notes. And I don't know any first-time authors who ever get that from somebody like Peter Baker. That was unbelievably lucky. So thank you, guys.
No, thank you. All right. So, so Chris, in your book, you talk about this role. It's a book about White House chief of staff. You talk about the role as a javelin catcher, confidant, consigliere, and battlefield commander. I spent the last 2 days writing about White House palace intrigue. What would Reince Priebus, if he read this book, and unfortunately he clearly hasn't, what would he get out of it in terms of lessons for his current situation in the current White House? What are the lessons that you should draw if you are a new White House chief of staff?
That's the wrong question. What should Trump...
Well, okay. Fair enough.
Because that depends on...
Yes.
So it's a two-part answer, really, because it's a question for Priebus, and it's a question for Trump, of course. For Priebus, God, where do I start? There's an awful lot for him to learn. These guys have to be diplomats to some extent. I don't. I think that the reality here is that this is the most dysfunctional White House in modern history. I think that in part, it's because Priebus has made a lot of rookie mistakes. He's done things that Duberstein or Jim Baker, the gold standard, would never have done. For example, no competent White House chief of staff would have allowed an executive order on immigration, a key campaign promise, to be sent out into the world without having it vetted by the departments that are in charge of enforcing it. The message, I don't need to tell anybody here, the daily message is a muddle. They've been unable to staff the White House adequately or the State Department. There have been so many rookie mistakes on Priebus's part, but in fairness to Priebus, the fundamental problem is that you have to have a president who is willing to empower the White House chief of staff to govern effectively. And the notion that, we can talk more about this later, but the notion that you can govern from the White House with five or six or more people coming and going with equal access and nobody who is first among equals has been a non-starter since Richard Nixon. And Jerry Ford tried it and called it the spokes of the wheel. It was a disaster. It took him a month to figure that out. There are many problems. I would hope that there might be some lessons to be learned.
Ken, you took over a White House that was having trouble. You were in the Reagan White House at the beginning, and then you left. You came back at a moment when Reagan's White House was struggling with Iran-Contra, and you and Howard Baker figured out how to right the ship. How would you right the current ship? What lessons from your time there would you provide to Reince Priebus today about how to change things? Obviously, every chief of staff can make mistakes, and Jim Baker took over an early White House. He wasn't Jim Baker the first couple months either. Everybody has a learning curve.
Was.
Well, but what can you do at this point given the situation?
Look, how you people a White House is absolutely crucial. You have a campaign staff that is not made for governing. You have to mix between a campaign staff who've been loyal to you during the hard battles of a campaign and the people who know how to get things done in Washington. And I'm sorry if you talk about drain the swamp, but the answer is you need a Jim Baker, a Darman, a Stockman, a Gergen, let alone me. And I'm not volunteering now. But people who know how to count votes, where the echo chamber is, who has relationships with the press and treats the press with respect. But you have to capture the process. You know, one of the most important jobs in the White House, besides chief of staff, is the staff secretary, the person who controls the paper flow. What Chris is talking about on the immigration is if you're circulating an executive order, you need to have it chopped off on by all sorts of people. That's a rookie mistake if it wasn't happening. Mm-hmm. You go up on a health care vote, you have to know where your votes are. Or you tell the president, it's not going to fly. And this is what we need to do as far as the order of how we're going to sequence it. What do we need to do to take charge? You learn quickly that you can't delegate to the Congress. You have to drive the process on something big like healthcare reform or tax reform or infrastructure. You can't just rely on the Congress. You need to drive the system. Reince is learning that. It's a sharp learning curve, but hopefully over a period of a few more months, he's going to be getting it right. But you also have to people the White House with the governing type. You know, I like to say that in a campaign, you try to annihilate your opponent. When you're governing, sometimes you have to make love to your opponent and say no to your fondest ally and your strongest ally. That's what governing is all about. Last item. Reagan believed that if he got 80% of what he wanted, he was ahead of the game. Old Tip O'Neill, the Speaker of the House, used to say, I don't like negotiating with Reagan because every time I do, Reagan gets 80% of what he wants. And Reagan would say to Jim Baker and me and others, I'll take 80% every time and come back the next year for the additional 20. That's what governing is all about. It's a lesson that this White House is now learning. It's not 100% or nothing. It's 80%.
So the last couple of days we've been talking a lot about the role of Steve Bannon. He, as you know, Steve Bannon is the president's chief strategist, former Breitbart News chairman, just yesterday removed from his position on the National Security Council's Principals Committee. It seems like every White House, or at least many White Houses, have people who are outside of the normal org chart, right? In your White House, you had early on, you had Michael Deaver, who's deputy chief of staff, but his title didn't fully reflect his relationship to the president. And Ed Meese, obviously, was counselor. You also had Nancy Reagan, who you, as chief of staff, talk about dealing with in this book, about how do you manage people who don't fit into neat little boxes and are important to a president.
Nancy never fit in any box.
That's a fair point.
Don't even suggest that.
Well, how do you, and I want to ask Chris this too, because how do you deal with, what do you do with a Steve Bannon who is important to your president, but is not chief of staff, and you are? What do you do with them?
You make sure that it funnel an awful lot of advice through the chief of staff. Mm-hmm. You can't have, as Jerry Ford learned, as you just mentioned, Chris, spokes of the wheel. If you have five people reporting to the president, it becomes a media show. And then Peter Baker gets stories every day.
I'm not against that.
Baker has another term for it that's much less polite.
I pulled my punches down. But it's in the book several times. But you always have to run it through. You know, everybody talks about end runs around the chief of staff. The reason the chief of staff is doing that is to help you, so in your presentation to the president gets it. And you're the honest broker, because when the door closes and it's only you and the president, he invariably will ask you what you think. That's not for public consumption, but that's where the decisions really are made. Mm-hmm. With Steve Bannon, I think the mistake that was made was, why didn't he just attend the meetings and why announce it?
Mm-hmm. Right.
Now they had to say he's been removed. Mm-hmm. Early on, and this is again process, come to the meeting. Mm-hmm. Why change the membership formally in an executive order?
Right, right.
Easy fix.
Right, right.
But they're learning.
Chris, I mean, are there Steve, in researching this book and looking at each White House, you looked at each White House going back to Nixon, are there Steve Bannons in the past, or is he a different type of figure?
Oh, absolutely. And, you know, every administration has a battle between Ken mentioned the campaign staff versus the people who know how to govern. You know, often it's a battle between the so-called true believers, the ideologues, and the pragmatists. And it certainly was in the case of Reagan and Jim Baker. And in that case, Baker's rival was Ed Meese, who had been chief of staff in Sacramento with Ronald Reagan, and was much more conservative, the leader of the true believers, really, within the West Wing. I love the way Baker handled that. What happened was Reagan, first of all, it was a great story about it, and Baker was somewhat surprised when I told him what Stu Spencer had said about how he got the job.
Tell us who Stu Spencer was.
Stu Spencer was the veteran campaign, Republican campaign manager who ran Ronald Reagan's successful campaign in 1980.
And ran Jerry Ford's in 76.
Ran Jerry Ford's in 76. You know, a brilliant, unfiltered wise man who was often brought in, sometimes by Ken, to tell Reagan stuff he didn't want to hear, and did the same with Jerry Ford. Anyway, Stu Spencer took Reagan aside, went to Reagan and Nancy right before the choice was made of Baker, and said, "You know, I'm hearing stuff on the street that the chief of staff is going to be Meese, and that's not good." And Reagan turned to Spencer and said, "Oh no, 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 no. Ed's not organized. It's got to be somebody else." Well, Spencer said Ed couldn't organize a two-car funeral, so that was. But in any event,
that the shake case was a black box.
That's right. Paper went in and never came out. But so that was one factor. But the story I was trying to get to is that Reagan turned to Baker and said, "Listen, make it right with Ed." The next morning, Jim Baker had breakfast with Ed Meese. He pulled out his yellow pad, and Baker, the savvy, smooth Texas lawyer, starts divvying up their responsibilities on the legal pad. And Meese winds up with a lot of fancy titles and cabinet rank. And Baker got everything that mattered. He was the gatekeeper in charge of who saw the president. He was in charge of the information flow, with the staff secretary reporting to him. He was in charge of executing policy. And that was the way Jim Baker took care of his Steve Bannon.
Mm-hmm. Right. That's a very good point. I mean, and I'm a fan of Jim Baker stories because my wife and I work in a biography of him, I'll confess. But it didn't always go smoothly, right? I mean, like, in that White House, in those early days, in fact, it was not as clear from the very start that Baker would emerge from this troika, they called it. The troika was Baker, Meese, and Deaver, that he would emerge as the first among equals. He didn't have a relationship to the president. He had run two campaigns against him, both George Bush and Gerald Ford. In fact, I think Ken would say, it says something about Reagan that he would choose somebody who had run two campaigns against him to be his chief of staff. So what does a chief of staff do to build a relationship with a president he doesn't really know, he doesn't have a long history with?
Perform. Mm. Right. Jim knew how to deliver for the president. Jim knew, and this will sound crazy because he had good relations with the press, that at the beginning he had a passion for anonymity, the old line about a staff person.
Right.
He understood that the president had been elected and he hadn't been. But his job was to take the Reagan agenda and the priorities and make sure that they got enacted. Reagan believed and told us all, to be viewed as an effective president, I have to win on Capitol Hill. That was Jim Baker. Mm-hmm. That was all of us. That was the legislative strategy group that we put together that captured politics and policy. Meese had the policy. You can have all the great policies you want in the world, but if you can't do anything with them, they don't get enacted, they don't get adopted. And nobody gets it, and it isn't sold to the American people. Jim controlled all of that.
Well, let me ask you.
That's how we emerged. And Nancy saw, and the president saw, that Jim was doing this on his behalf.
I mean, Nancy, the personnel director. Yes.
Among other things.
Well, you would...
Trust me, I never hung up on Nancy Reagan.
That's the story of Donald Reagan, who didn't survive much longer after that. Right. So you're...
And, by the way, and she was always helpful. Oh. There was never a time that I didn't find her help. And one of the interesting things is you think about it. Every morning when the president came downstairs at 9 o'clock, about 10 minutes of 9, I would get a phone call. And it was from Nancy Reagan telling me he had slept well the night before, he was feeling okay. This is what was bothering him, that he read in the newspapers that morning or had seen on TV, to give me a head start for adjusting his day or getting ahead of what he was going to ask me, because she knew I was there to serve the president. And it made me more effective, and therefore her husband more effective.
Chris quotes you, and I want to come back to Chris on this. Chris quotes you in the book saying, President Reagan didn't hire me for my good looks.
Trust me, that's true.
He hired me because he knew I would tell him straight, because right. That's the Brooklyn way. So how do you tell a president no? I hear a lot of people say this, I'm going to tell the president this and that. But the truth is, you go in that Oval Office, even for a reporter who's in charge of being asking nasty questions, that's a pretty intimidating thing.
Everybody gets cotton in their mouth.
Yeah.
Everybody tells the president what they think he wants to know and not what he needs to know.
Did you ever do that?
No.
Nope.
It's a Brooklyn way. Growing up in the streets of
what
Brooklyn.
Was the hardest thing you had to say no to him?
Each day?
You give an example.
I'll come back on that.
Well, Chris, from your research, what are some examples of moments when chiefs of staff...
Oh, I'll give you one.
All right.
It's not when I was chief of staff.
All right.
When I was head of legislative affairs.
Still counts.
First term. One of the big mistakes I made was that I was the person responsible for bringing C-SPAN to the White House. Mm. What I didn't realize, I was responsible because I got a flyer in the mail that said $89 a month. And we had been given a proposal from the Carter administration for $1.5 million to run a cable through the metro system, and I said no to that. What I didn't realize is that Reagan would go upstairs at night and watch the House of Representatives floor proceedings. And invariably he would call me and say, did you hear what that, whatever the congressman was, just said? And I said, no, I wasn't watching. And he would say, this is what he said, and he's wrong. I'm going to call him and straighten him out. And I said, Mr. President, you can't do that. Mm-hmm. Because if you do that, it becomes a front page story. Mm-hmm. And you might as well not have done everything else.
Mm-hmm. That's a good example.
Another example. The shouted question from Sam Donaldson. Iran-Contra. Every day before we passed the press corps, I would say, Mr. President, if you answer Sam's shouted question on Iran-Contra, don't give the speech. Don't spend any time in the Oval Office, because nothing else is going to be covered. And you might as well not have done anything other than answer Sam's question. I got it. I won't. And for 4 or 6 weeks, he'd be great with that. But I remind him several times a day.
So, Chris, what was... We'll come
and about 6 weeks, every 6 weeks, he couldn't take it anymore, would answer Sam's question. And sure enough, that night, what would lead the network news?
Yeah.
Iran-Contra.
Thank God for Sam Donaldson.
Right. I won't do it again. I'll be a good boy. See, Mr. President, I was right. Okay.
Ken also gave orders to rev up the helicopter on the lawn so that no one could hear Sam's shouted question.
You never want to put the president in a position where you have to lie. Right. And so when the president used to cup his ear and say, I can't hear you, the reason why is because inside the diplomatic entrance room, there is a telephone that you connect to the helicopter on the South Lawn. And I would say, or tell somebody to call him and say, start the engines. Because that way, the president would not be lying when he's like, Sam, I can't hear you. Excuse me.
So, Chris, other than Reagan, what are examples, or a good example, of a chief of staff who said no to a president? And give us one where a chief of staff didn't say no, but should have.
Well, I'll give you a couple of examples. One, the first pretty extreme, involving Richard Nixon and H.R. Bob Haldeman. The Nixon White House was pretty bad, and it was pretty corrupt, but it could have been even worse. Haldeman, despite the fact, I mean, Haldeman's a fascinating character to me, because the irony is that he became the poster child for Watergate, and yet he was the guy who often Not only did he create the template for the modern White House chief of staff, but he was the guy who talked Nixon off the ledge a number of times. Nixon ordered him to firebomb the Brookings Institute. Another time, Nixon ordered him to do polygraphs on every member of the State Department. There were something like 11,000. I don't know how many thousand employees there were, but Haldeman would say, okay. Haldeman would leave. He'd come back a day later, and Nixon would ask him, what happened? Did you do that? And he said, well, no. And Nixon would say, yeah, I guess you probably shouldn't have done that. So that was the way Haldeman handled it. On a more substantive, I'm really interested in posing this to Ken, because I want to give an example of something Reagan did and something maybe Priebus should have done. Ronald Reagan was hell-bent on going to Capitol Hill as the first major initiative of his presidency. He wanted to reform Social Security. Jim Baker, he was smart enough to have a savvy insider like Jim Baker as chief, and Jim Baker knew that that was what he called the third rail of American politics. You touch it, you get electrocuted. He went to Reagan and explained this. Reagan didn't want to hear it, but ultimately when Baker corralled Nancy and others to support him on this, he came around and pursued tax reform as his first major, and the rest is history. So that's an example.
Tax cut.
The tax cut. Yeah. So that's an example of a president speaking truth to power in a very effective way, and I just wonder if Jim Baker had been, or Leon Panetta or Ken Duberstein had been chief of staff, and Trump told you that he was going to do repeal and replace Obamacare, and he's got a bill that's incoherent, that makes no sense, and even if passed, would come back to bite your base by removing their health care benefits, what would you have told him?
The votes aren't there. It's going to be more of a headache than you realize. You're going to use up an awful lot of chips. Start with infrastructure, because it's on a bipartisan basis. You can reach out to the Democrats, and you can start building some new friendships. It is interesting that in the media, but not the New York Times, I don't think, in the last couple of days, there was a story that Mark Short, who's now head of legislative affairs, had met with the so-called moderate Democrats in the House. And I chuckled, because it's now April. Our first meeting with some of the conservative Democrats in our time took place during transition in 1980, mm-hmm. about 5 months before this group. So I would have focused on infrastructure, tax reform, and if you build a winning coalition, and even though coalitions continue, but they're always a little bit different, you then come into something like health care.
You know,
what the mistake I think that was made is that they relied on the Hill rather than counting their own votes. Yeah. You don't want to use up all your chips right away.
Yeah.
That answer your question?
Yeah.
Let me ask one last question, because we're going to have people from the audience come up with questions. There are microphones here and there. And by the way, you mentioned that in our story tomorrow, we're going to report that Reince Priebus actually brought in Speaker Ryan and other people last night because he was trying to press them to do a quick vote on health care, saying he just wanted to have a vote before they left town today. And Paul Ryan had to say, that's not how it's going to work. We're not going to pass anything.
Look, in my reading, and I don't have any inside information, I think the way that they were working on a bill this week was not to have a vote this week.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It was to give the members cover when they went back home. We're still working on it.
Right, exactly.
Rather than forcing a vote where you don't have 218 votes.
All right, here's my last question, then we'll please go ahead and you can line up, I suppose, at these microphones. How would you take away Donald Trump's Twitter account? Would that be a make or break thing for you as chief of staff? Because you talk about the discipline of not answering Sam's question. Well, how about the discipline of waking up Saturday morning and accusing a predecessor of a crime?
No, I would occupy his time.
Yeah.
So he didn't have time to do Twitter. For example, I would have somebody scheduled to have dinner with him every night from 8 to 10:30, 11 o'clock. And then I would have somebody having an early morning breakfast with him upstairs in the residence. Yeah. That's a different way of diversion. But I give him great credit, and I don't have quite as much problem with the Twitter account. It's just some of the tweets.
Yeah.
Okay. Reagan figured out that in spite of all the great journalists that there are, that he wanted 5 minutes to speak to the American people directly. And in our day, that was the radio program, which is now standard.
Right.
Okay. You gotta give Donald Trump credit that he's figured out a way to communicate directly.
That's right.
And it breaks through a lot of the mass, and it creates its own stories, mm-hmm. good or bad.
He controls the agenda.
And he controls the agenda, and that's what a president wants to do.
Right.
But I think you need to watch those hours in the evening and early mornings where it seems, and Saturday mornings, I think you all demonstrate, are the most vulnerable.
They do seem to be.
And figure out ways to manage his time so that you don't go off and have these tweets.
Right. What about anybody out here? Do we have questions for Chris or for Ken? Questions rather than statements, right?
Oh, I thought you were leaving. Thank you.
No, I'm here for the duration, and this is not a statement. This is a question. It may be a slightly multi-part question, but the three of you are ideal, really, for this. The gatekeeper role of the chief of staff, you've alluded to it a few times, but haven't really talked in great depth about it and how important it is. And in particular, the gatekeeping role, and as part of that, the so-called walk-in privileges to the president. So I want to ask in general about that, and if you would talk about that. And,
sure.
But let me give you a particular anecdote, a recent anecdote that I think may be illustrative here. I don't know. I hope that it is. So yesterday, the New York Times was offered late in the morning, I think, to come and meet with the president and talk about infrastructure. And so it turned out that that's not the way the conversation went. But one of the comments coming out of that interview, apparently, was, quote, that it was like Grand Central Station in there with many, many people walking in and out, one of those being Reince Priebus himself. And many other people, at least the impression I got from the report, was that it was really quite a throng coming in and out. So the question is, this particular question is, is it possible this is indicative of a gatekeeper problem there, that there may be too many people with walk-in privileges, or was this simply a reflection that this was an unusual kind of circumstance, that the New York Times wasn't really there to do an interview, they just wanted to tell him about Susan Rice and so forth.
If I can start on that, the short answer is yes, there is a problem with the gatekeeping role. I'm sort of reminded of when you talk about everybody being in the Oval Office for a meeting. I'm reminded of the early days of Bill Clinton, and Peter knows this better than anybody. When somebody once said that they went from war room, which was the famously disciplined campaign operation, to dorm room. Everybody was in the Oval. People who shouldn't have, every Tom, Dick, and Harry, as Leon Panetta put it, would show up for meetings in the Oval Office. And as a result, nothing got done. I'm exaggerating now slightly, but and in fairness to Mac McClarty, who was Clinton's first chief of staff, Mac was a really able, smart guy. Bill Clinton didn't want to be disciplined at that point. Bill Clinton didn't want an empowered White House chief, and so I think it was mission impossible for Mac. But just briefly, and Ken knows this much better than I do, the answer to your question about the gatekeeping role, it's critical that, Don Rumsfeld, when he was Jerry Ford's White House chief, used to talk about the hazard of, oh, by the way, decisions. That's what happens when somebody goes in and sees the president. The chief of staff has no idea that person is there, doesn't know what the agenda is, and the president says, sure, Senator so-and-so, yeah, let's do that. And it's something completely inconsistent with the president's agenda. It contradicts a number of other orders they've already signed, and it becomes a mess. You've got to have a chief of staff who's almost always in the room when those meetings are taking place. It's about focus. It's about discipline, right?
The gatekeeper role is absolutely fundamental. You know, I thought Reagan was much better meeting with people than just reading memos.
Right.
Anybody could go see the president on the White House staff or the cabinet, but they had to stop in my office first.
Right.
Sometimes I went, and sometimes I sent my deputy. Because you also didn't want the, oh, by the way, while I'm here, let me mention three other things. That's the way you have to handle it. You know, Colin Powell was National Security Advisor when I was Chief of Staff. Colin invariably would stop in my office and say, let's go see the boss. Here's what the issue is, but I may not have it. This is a foreign policy issue, but the answer is there's always something domestic as an overlay, or vice versa.
Right.
So it was seamless. You can have five people wanting to see the president, but you get to decide what order there is. And you're the one who gives the president a heads up.
Right.
This is what he wants to talk to you about. And here are the key points to that.
Right.
So it's managing the Oval Office, but also managing the staff or a senator. You have no idea how many senators or congressmen want to see the president, because it's on behalf of a constituent.
Right.
They're trying to take care of a constituent, and we're trying to figure out why isn't it in their best interest, even though they're walking and saying, oh, but Mr. President, it's in your best interest. It's never in the president's best interest first. It's the president's best interest second. And your belly button has to tell you what the reason is that they think it's in their self-interest.
Right. So any comments on, as was yesterday's events in the White House?
I wasn't one of the reporters who went, so I shouldn't describe it. But it was a crowded room, as I understand it from my colleagues, and people did kind of come in and out. And it is a more free-flowing operation than probably Ken ran and certainly others ran. So we'll see if that changes. You know, he likes that. Trump likes, I'll say this about President Trump, you know, he has been a successful businessman and entertainer for, you know, decades, and he's running it the way he feels like he was successful, and that encourages chaos. It may not work in a White House, but that's the nature of his management style.
And you got to keep going back to the idea that he was elected as an outsider.
Right. With no first
and he
president
was elected that way.
First president ever. Yeah. Right. With no government or military experience.
Outsiders always need insiders to get anything done.
Well,
thank you very much.
Over here, ma'am.
Yeah. Reagan and, of course, Clinton both had governing experience, and they had people like you and other professional people around them that sort of tamed their worst instincts. We don't seem to have that now. And we about his children that in the White House is what I was going to ask about. What?
Reagan was the ultimate pragmatist, and I know that Jim Baker gets accused of it. I get accused of it, and several people on the White House staff. We were the prags. The person who always wanted to cut the deal was Reagan. Now, I know that doesn't flow with conservative orthodoxy, but he understood what governing was all about.
Well, exactly.
So it's not his worst instincts. His worst instincts are sometimes to compromise too quickly.
Well, okay, but maybe okay. Instincts anyway, right. Maybe to rush around. What we seem to have now, and I've seen this in columns, you know, is we have a bull in the china shop, and there doesn't seem to be anybody who seems to be able to rein him in. And I thought perhaps that, you know, his children in the White House were going to be sentries, as it were, but that doesn't seem to be happening. Is Priebus going to come rise up to it? What's going to happen here? It's really extremely unnerving to see what's happening.
Chris, what do you think about that? Relatives in the White House. Did you see much of that in your research?
Well, again, we keep going back to Baker and Reagan. When I actually wrote an article for Vanity Fair back in December when Priebus was appointed and suggested that history, that he take a page from Baker's book and reach out to Jared Kushner. You know, he was always, Bannon was always going to be a problem and an irritant and, you know, a threat. and it seemed to me that Priebus might be the pragmatist in this mix, and that he should reach out to Kushner. You know, that's what Jim Baker did with Mike Deaver, who was practically family. He wasn't blood tie. But anyway, I mean, I think I don't see any indication, any evidence that Donald Trump wants to have a grown-up in the room. And I think that's fundamentally the problem here. I mean, no matter how competent Priebus might be, you've got to have a president who's willing to listen to somebody who tells him what he doesn't want to hear. And the other thing is that, you know, running a family real estate business in Manhattan is nothing like governing. It's nothing like running the federal government. And you can't do it with, you know, a bunch of lieutenants who are all at each other's throats thinking this is somehow going to create creative tension. It's proven non-starter.
We're going to wrap up in a minute so that Chris can sign books. But, you know, the first family member who actually had an office in the West Wing, of course, was Hillary Clinton. A step beyond what Nancy ever would have done, Nancy Reagan would have done. How did Chiefs of Staff deal with that?
Well, I think that Hillary was, you know, as you well know, I mean, people thought she was the chief of staff from time to time. And I think that, you know, the chiefs who were successful with Clinton were the ones who paid a lot of attention to Hillary and her needs. And of course, John Podesta, Clinton's final chief of staff, became very close with her. And I think, but they all paid very careful attention to Hillary, and because not only because she was so influential, but because she was pretty smart too. So, you know, Ken can talk about the importance of taking care of or paying attention to first ladies, but you probably know that story better than I do.
All I would say is that I have about 15 lessons from being a White House chief of staff. And one of them is the care and feeding of a first lady. Absolutely fundamental. Because Nancy always had my back, and we always had our conversations. And there are times that I asked Nancy to weigh in with the president when I couldn't push something across a line. And if she agreed with me, she did it.
What if she didn't agree with you?
Many times she did.
Right over here.
Can you comment on Bush 43's White House, the commencement of the war at all with his chief of staff?
Yeah, one of the...
Could I interrupt?
Please.
The chapter in the book that deals with this is absolutely riveting. Mm. Okay.
To my surprise, really, as I started to dig into this, the walk-up to the Iraq War, I wound up being told a pretty amazing story by James Baker. And one of the problems in the Bush 43 White House, in my opinion, is that I think Colin Powell was right when he said that, you know, he felt that Vice President Cheney's outsized influence and power in that White House made it very difficult for Andy Card, the actual chief of staff, to be an honest broker of information. And he had to deal with these warring factions. He had Vice President Cheney, Secretary of State Colin Powell. He had a very powerful Defense Secretary, Don Rumsfeld. So it was almost kind of mission impossible, particularly because President Bush 43 didn't empower Andy Card in the same way that Ronald Reagan had empowered Jim Baker. So Andy had a tough job, and in the walk-up to the Iraq War, when Colin Powell was being undercut by these other factions,
by Cheney and Rumsfeld,
Jim Baker and the president's father, George H.W. Bush, were so alarmed by this and so concerned that Jim Baker went privately to Colin Powell and told him, with Bush 41's blessing, you need to go into the president and tell him that this is not what you signed up for. And he told him essentially to fall on his sword. And as Baker put it to me, he never did it. When I relayed this version of events to Colin Powell, he was not completely in agreement with the way that it took place. He said he didn't remember a conversation quite as stark as that. But he said, if Jim Baker says he said it, I'm not going to deny it. But anyway, it's a riveting story, and you have that whole sort of drama between father and son, too. I mean, Bush 41 never willing to confront his son with his real doubts about the impending war.
Well, there's so many gripping stories in this book, not just that one, so many other ones. You have to buy it. If you haven't already bought it, go get a copy. Come on up here. Chris is going to sign. And
if you already bought one, boy, another.
Buy more. Thank you, Ken. Thank you, Chris. Appreciate it. It was great to.
One more round of applause.
What a pleasure.
Thank you all so much for coming out tonight. Books are available for purchase behind the budget.